everything that can be shaken will be shaken, and only that which cannot be shaken will remain.
Well, hallelujah. Glory to God. You know, David of old said, I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of the Lord. Glory be to God. And I'm so thankful that actually we're the house, the real temple. And when we come together collectively, then we open our spirit up for the glory of God to manifest. Amen. So that's why we're here. Praise God. We have some good prayer in that back room. The anointing is present. Trust me. The anointing is present. If you stir up your heart and you put your faith out there, you're going to sense the anointing of God. Amen. Well, Sam asked me to open up because there are some other things going on. And what I want to share with you to prepare us is preparation, expectation, and edification. You got that? Preparation. What is preparation? Preparing our heart for what God is going to do. He's already got a pattern. He's already got a plan, and we want to engraft into that plan and that pattern for today, don't we? And so preparation, preparing our hearts to come into the house of God together. Amen? Because when we come in, when we prepare our hearts individually, then when we come together, it's going to be a corporate anointing. There can be an individual anointing and stirring up things, but then there's a corporate anointing. And that's where the greater anointing lies. And that's where the gifts of the Spirit start operating. And that's when things in open heaven comes. And things can be wrought in the Spirit and by the Spirit. Because if it's not in the Spirit and by the Spirit, there is nothing. It avails to nothing. And so it's always in the Spirit and by the Spirit. And we all have a part in bringing that to pass, right? So when we leave out of here, we'll know that when we leave, nothing will be left undone. Amen? Here in Psalms 119, it's one of my most favorite psalms. And if most of us should know Psalms 119, every verse has something about the testimony, the precept, the statutes, the word. In all of Psalms 119, it's very long. But here, the Lord opened my eyes to this one time. And in verse 18 of Psalms 119, it says, open thou mine eyes. This is part of preparation. You say in your heart, open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. What do you want? You want an open heaven. You want God to open your eyes to behold the things that are coming out of his word. Pastor has been preparing, and there's some things the Lord's dropped down into his spirit. And it's like, what do? God, open thou our eyes that we may behold wondrous things. That word, that impartation will go into our spirit. And that we can grow by that. We have that expectation. We expect the word. We expect the wondrous things out of your word to come into our spirit, to be imparted. Amen. And it's all for edification and a building up. And then he says here, behold, I have longed after your precepts. Quicken me in thy righteousness. The quickened word of God. Because why? We long for eyes to be open to the quickening word of God. If it's just a word we read off of a paper, you know, pages, then it avails to nothing because it's spirit to spirit, spirit to spirit. Jesus said, my words are spirit and they're life to your spirit, because that's what breeds life into you. That's what breeds his truth into you. That's what breeds a building up into you, a building up and a maturing in the things of God. But it has to come through beholding the wondrous things out of here with the anointing of God. Amen. So when we come together, I mean, you know, we just don't come in here and just start getting prepared. No, we're already preparing out there. We're preparing all week. The Lord just drops things, and we prepare. We're thinking about it. You say, well, you're the ministers. Y'all need to be thinking about it. Yes, that's true. But the thing is, It's like you want a corporate, you want a greater anointing? You want a greater anointing? Then be thinking about things. Let the Holy Ghost, let him behold wondrous things out of his law during the week. So when you come, we all have a supply. Even if it's in faith, the Lord's been quickening me. Amen? And then the other scripture is, let's see. This is my comfort in my affliction. If you're dealing with an affliction, he says, for thy word hath quickened me. Thy word hath quickened me. It'll get rid of, it'll go down to the deepest of the deep, and it'll root up, tear down, destroy whatever hell's tried to build. Amen? And then what does the prophetic word do? When you behold it and it quickens you, it builds back up. It builds up, and it's like, here you are. You're standing in the anointing of God, and all is well. Amen. Because it's the anointing that destroys the yoke. Glory be to God. Outside of the Holy Ghost and the anointing of God, it's like we just can't get it. We don't do it. We can't experience it. Anyway, John 6:65, Jesus said, my words, they're spirit, they're life. They're spirit and life. And over here, and as pastor gets up to minister, even as we get into this place of worship and we get still before God, what we're doing is we're opening up our spirit. This team right here that's coming, they're going to hit a sound in the realm of the spirit that's going to open up the womb of the spirit. Because why? We're going into his gates with thanksgiving and praise. We're going into that place where God is preparing us and we're giving him glory and thanksgiving. And that's where the word becomes, our hearts become soft and we can open up to behold those things that God wants to say today. Amen. And to do. Amen. So we pray for them that they'll hit that place. And he said here, so what do we say? Preparation, expectation, and edification. And edification. And he said, all scripture, when we behold it, it's quickened to us. He said, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. That is a mouthful. What is it? Inspiration of God. All scripture. When pastor is ministering, it's like inspiration is given by God. Amen? And he said, and is profitable for doctrine. It's profitable for you. For doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Why? That the man of God may be perfect or mature, thoroughly furnished into all good works. Glory be to God. Stand to your feet. So we thank God. We thank God for the Holy Ghost. He's the one that brings to our remembrance, even things that we've already sown into our spirit. The Holy Ghost is the one that brings to our remembrance things that we need to know, no matter what's going on around us. Amen. That's what we call when you sow the word of God, that it is quickened by the Holy Ghost. And when it's quickened by the Holy Ghost, Katie barred the door. Hell has to obey the quickened word. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Lift your hands to God. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you today. We thank you, Lord God, for the quickened word of God, the inspired word of God. We thank you, Lord God, that we're spirit beings made after your likeness. And Lord, as we go into this place of worship, Father, that we go in, Father, with our hearts full, Father God, that you love us, that you've forgiven us, Lord God, that you, Father God, just by the blood, we can enter in freely, Father, to love on you, Jesus, and bring thanksgiving to you, and thanking you for the grace that abounds toward us in every way. So, Father, thank you for your will today. Thank you for the quickened word, the wondrous word, Father, the Spirit Word of God, hallelujah, whoo, hallelujah, and the voice of God, the prophetic voice of God to be among us, that we can hear it, see it, feel it, walk in it, built in it. Glory be to God, even today, Father, we seal the service in the blood of Jesus. Can you say amen?
And all and free at last. Free at last. Thank God Almighty, I am free at last. And all my chains are hid in the past. Thank God Almighty, I am free at last. Where the Spirit the Lord Almighty. the chain. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Every knee.
One more time, our God. For the sins of the world, His blood breaks the chain. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Every knee.
Take a seat. We'll get the offering in a second. There's some things that I wanted to share first before taking it up. Let me get to it. Well, praise the Lord. You know, I was just thinking about that song. You know, Jesus is the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. But if you think about it, Jesus died a lamb, but He rose a lion.
Yes.
Revelation says He has a fire in His eyes. That depicts a lion.
Yes.
And you know what happens? You see, sometimes I think we think about Jesus and we think of this sweet lamb. But have you ever seen a lion when their cubs are in danger? It's a fierce animal. Fierce. And you know, when you think about Jesus, when you're coming under attack of the enemy, Jesus isn't over here like, oh, it's okay. He's a fierce lion ready to war on your behalf. And He doesn't play nice with the enemy. It's like a sick puppy. He just drags it by its head and He just drags it along. He's fierce. He's a lion. So when you're going through battles and you're calling on Jesus and you're believing in the blood, don't think Jesus is just walking up having a conversation with Satan. He's coming armed. He's coming ready for battle. He's coming ready to just tear up the enemy to reinforce what He's already done. He's not doing a new work. He's reinforcing the work He's already completed. Amen. Hallelujah. So the Lord has been talking to me a little bit about apprehending and contending. And I wanted to share some things this morning, which is similar to what even Pastor Betty shared. I had no clue you were going to say that stuff. And I'm going to be as quick as I can be. Jude chapter 1 verse 3 says, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints." Amen?
Yes.
Amen. Contend. That's the word. Contend. The next, Philippians 3:12 says, "Not as though I have already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, that I may apprehend that which I am apprehended of Jesus Christ." And real quick, the word apprehend means to catch, to seize, to pull. Another meaning means to understand or perceive, to realize, to appreciate, to discern, to grasp, to get the picture. He's saying that I want to grasp what God has already grasped for me. I want to siege what God has already sieged for me. Amen?
Yeah.
Contend means to engage in competition or a campaign in order to win or achieve something. It means to fight, to wrestle, to battle, to war, to assert a position, to maintain or to hold, to declare, profess, and claim. It's a battle. You're contending. When they talk about a contender, they're saying somebody who's in in the race to win something, to achieve something, to win the prize. Amen? But this is the thing I wanted to talk to you about this morning. If anybody remembers Elijah, everybody know who Elijah is? When he, after the fire fell and everything happened, and he told Ahab, he said, go eat and drink. And remember, he went up to the mountain to go pray again, and he began to pray for rain. And he prayed for rain one time, and what happened? He told his servant to go and look and see if there's rain. Was there rain? So what did he do? He prayed again. And how many times did he pray and go send his servant to go look for rain? Seven times, okay? And then on the seventh time, he said, I see a cloud. It's like a little one in the rise. And he said, basically, Elijah said, the manifestation is here. The answer is here. Go tell the king to get ready because it's coming fast. Amen? And if you look at what that word is, what did he do? He contended. He contended. And if you look at James, James talks about Elijah. It says, it talks about the prayer of healing, the prayer of faith will heal the sick. And then the next word he goes into is Elijah was a man of like nature, meaning he was just like us. And he starts going into, and he prayed and the heavens quit raining. And then it says, and he prayed again and the heavens produced. See, but it doesn't tell you how many times he had to pray. He had to pray seven times. Why? Because he had to contend for the miracle. He had to contend for what the Lord wanted to do. And that's what the Lord kind of was putting on my heart was when it comes to Faith Harvest Church, when you come to this church, you're now sitting under a vision. It is not the pastor's vision, it's the Lord's vision that the Lord is directing through the pastors. Amen? And so there's a thing called contending for the vision. It's contending. Now, you're going to have to contend into your own life, but when it comes to the corporate, there's things we have to contend for concerning the vision of Faith Harvest Church. Amen? Was Moses the reason the Israelites went in or did not go into the Promised Land? Was Moses the reason they went in or the reason they were in the desert for 40 years? Was it Moses' fault? Whose fault was it? It was the 10 spies, right? Two had a good report, 10 didn't. And the whole company, the leader, even Moses himself, stayed out of the Promised Land because of 10 people's report. If the Promised Land, let's say, is a move of God, let's say it's revival, let's say it's the vision, it wasn't up to the leadership whether the people entered into the vision. It was up to the congregation. It was the corporate. Everybody has to be in unity. And so that's what I was just feeling this week. I said, Lord, when it comes to just preparing for service, listen, God's not waiting. We're not waiting on God to drop revival. He's waiting on us. Are we in position? As we shared last week, for the Kairos moment, are you in position for the Kairos moment? Are you ready for when the Lord's ready to drop it, sensitive enough to know it's here, it's now? And how do you become sensitive? You spend time with the Lord. You spend time praying, you prepare, you expect, and then you receive the edification. Amen? Yes. And there's things that it's not just all spiritual. There are natural things we do to contend for the vision, for the faith, for the service. I mean, if you think about it, God looks at small acts of obedience. Are we tithing? Is the church tithing? Listen, a tithe is what you owe. A seed is what you sow. Okay? The tithe is not, am I going to receive in abundance because of what I've sown? That is an act of obedience. That's the 10%. And you say, well, some people say, well, that's a part of the law. I don't have to do it. No, Abraham tithed to Melchizedek, who's Jesus, follows after the order of Melchizedek. So if we're going to follow that order, a 10% is what we owe to God. But if you really want to be blessed, it's not in the tithe, it's in the seed. The tithe is just the option of obedience. The seed above the tithe, it determines, are you going to receive a crop of blessing? Amen? So what the Lord has been telling me, that, and another thing too, so the tithe is important. Tithes and offering are crucial when it comes to the Lord breaking out a vision. Amen? The second thing is this, the Lord began to talk to me about, is even things like being on time. Why? The worship team gets here at 9 a.m. They're practicing, they're preparing, they're getting ready. Listen, encouragers need encouragement. And how many of you know when people are here, it's an encouragement? The Holy Ghost values being on time greatly. because he's preparing all week. He has pastor in the prayer closet. He has pastor preparing the word. He has the worship teams pick this song, pick that song for the opening of the offering. He's saying, hey, this word, how many times has the offering, the opening, the sermon, and the worship all lined up?
Yep.
Without anybody talking about each other what they're sharing. Why? Because the Holy Ghost is setting stuff up. People are spending time in the secret place getting ready, and the Holy Ghost is bringing all this together, all this together. And when 10:30 hits, he's expecting to release it. But if people aren't here, he says, I really need them to get it, so I can't release the fullness of it because it's not ready, it's not time. Mama makes supper. Last thing I'm going to say. When mama makes supper and she says supper's ready, it's hot, and the kids don't come running immediately, what does mama do? She starts going around, grabbing those kids, bringing them into the kitchen. Why? Because she expects when the food is ready, the children should be sitting down. The Holy Ghost is cooking up a meal every service for us. And when he says it's hot, it's ready, it's starting, he doesn't want it to cool off. When it comes to the presence of God, when it comes to a service, when things, it can cool off.
Yes. Yeah.
And then we say, well, it just wasn't the greatest service today. I just don't know what happened. We have to contend. And a part of contending is doing natural things. Yeah. Amen?
Amen.
Even this morning as they were practicing for worship, everything in the world, Christian, you can go ahead and take up the offering. Trying not to be long. But everything that, even with the worship team, I mean, the sound system was going crazy this morning. Just going crazy. And I said, Lord, okay, I already know what this is. This is warfare. Why? Because we're contending for something, and the enemy's always going to fight back. So as you go through this week, even the rest of this worship, wrestle for the atmosphere to change. Elijah wasn't fighting a demon when he was praying again. He was wrestling the atmosphere to change to the word of the Lord. Sometimes you have to wrestle in worship, wrestle in prayer, just for an atmosphere change.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
So, Christian, go ahead and take that up. As he's taking it up, we're just going to pray for the offering. Also, we do have the contribution letters today. We'll get to get those. Don't leave before they're passed out. As you leave the door, we'll have somebody there giving each other a contribution letter. We don't want to take any more time up than we already are. Hallelujah. Go ahead and stand to your feet. Hallelujah. You know, and sometimes you got to contend and apprehend when it comes to finances. How many of you want to be a blessing?
Yes.
How many of you want to be blessed?
Yes.
The Lord doesn't say he loves a cheerful blessed. He said he loves a cheerful giver.
Yes.
We have to bless someone in order to be blessed.
Yep.
We shouldn't be looking always to receive. We should be looking to dish out. Amen?
Amen.
You just dished out. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. So let's, by faith together, let's contend that this is going to come back a blessing.
Right.
Amen?
Yes.
And then when we're done with the offering, we're going to contend together that this next set of worship is going to usher in the glory.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
I don't know about you, but I want the glory. I've been watching Bay Revival videos. I've been listening to Supernatural Turnaround, things when the glory came. You don't want anything else. A normal service won't cut it. It starts here and now. So stretch your hands. You can go ahead and begin to softly play. Father, we just thank you for this blessing that we have given, that we've just dished out. Father, I pray right now, Father God, Lord, we strike it with the blood of Jesus. Father, we take our authority and tell Satan, take your hands off this blessing. Take your hands off our accounts, our finances. Lord, take his hands off of it right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask that you put your hand upon it, that you begin to multiply it, and you begin to dish it out, Lord, that more comes into the store. Storehouses, so that more can be dished out of the storehouses, Father God, that it can be a continual process, Lord Jesus. Father, we plead the blood of Jesus over it right now. And Father, concerning this next round of worship and the rest of the service, Father God, Lord, we just speak to the atmosphere. We pray for rain in this place today. Father, we command rain to come in this place today. Father, we command the atmosphere to become conducive to the glory of God. Father, we take it by faith and by force. Father God, we command the airways to become clear, that open heaven, that ladder of Jacob saw, Lord God, that angels begin to descend and ascend in this place, and they begin to dish out what needs to be dished out. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that every addiction is broken in this place today. Lord, we take authority over every bondage in this place today. Father, every addiction and every bondage, Lord, we take authority over anger and bitterness and unforgiveness. Father, we strike the roots of everything that keeps those bound and hurting, Lord God. Lord, we take authority over depression today and anxiety and the burdens of life. Lord, we just clear the room, Father, of everything, Lord God, that would cause your glory to just to stay, to depart. Oh, we usher it in, Lord God. We usher it in, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Song. Your face, and Glory to your name. Glory to your name. Thank you, you, Lord. Somebody give him a big hug. Glory. Hallelujah. Just shout. Just shout unto him the voice of triumph. He's worthy. Hallelujah.
Well, glory. It's good to see everybody today. Hallelujah. Always good to see every one of you every week. I trust the Lord's been good to you this week. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm excited today. God has already blessed us to where we could, if we went home right now, we'd know we've been edified and blessed. Amen. But he does have some things he wants me to share with you. In fact, while I was standing over there and we were in that worship, I was thinking, Lord, man, this could turn out to just be one of those services where we just laid aside the sermon and just got on our face. Because the presence of God was so strong. And then I just immediately heard the Holy Spirit say, yeah, but I got something for them today. So we're going to just go into the Word. Amen. Praise God. Excited about that. Praise the Lord. Those of you that were with us last Sunday, or if you had a chance to watch the video online, you remember that we shared with you about how Jesus, it's all about Jesus. Everything's got to be centered on Him. And that this is what we are proclaiming for this year, that this is the year of the Son, S-O-N, and that everything's got to go back to Him. It's a reset. This is a year for reset. And I found this to be very interesting. Didn't know this until I began to do my preparation for this weekend. But there is an organization that's was founded in Switzerland. Some of you may be familiar with it. I wasn't familiar with it. It's called the World Economic Forum. It was founded years ago, but it's actually right now working feverishly, listen to this, to help shape global development around this COVID-19 pandemic. And it has to do with the business, the politics, and the academia of the whole world and having to shape a new perspective. Now, let me tell you something, folks. The world is working very feverishly to get this thing all set up for the Antichrist.
Yep, that's right.
And, you know, the thing that I thought was very, very interesting is that this organization has initiated a new platform called the Great Reset Initiative. The Great Reset Initiative. Now, God spoke to us already about this year being a reset before I even knew that there was such a thing. Now, when I heard this, it immediately drew me back to something the Lord said to me in preparing for a sermon December 11th, 2011. Some of you in this room were probably here in 2011. Some of you weren't. But as I was preparing, I kept hearing this word change, change. And of course, my message was founded in 2 Corinthians 3:18. We behold in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. And that change had to do with the glory. Well, as I began to prepare that lesson, I heard this in the Spirit and I wrote it down. There is a change that's about to take place. There is some turning. Now listen very carefully to this. There is some turning that's about to happen, and it is going to affect everything. Yes. Not only in the natural, but in the spiritual. There is a parallel to the things that are going on in the natural that goes on into the spirit realm. There is a sovereign element about to take place where God is going to step in and do some things that He is going to do by His Spirit. And then I wrote down, we've been called into a season of preparation for what we know God is calling us to. Now, when I wrote that down in December 2011, I went back in my manual that I wrote in, I think it was 2014, in the Bible school on the anointing. We have that manual available to everyone. But in 1998, 23 years ago, you know, you just got to be mindful that the Lord's timing is different than our timing. But He said this to me. He said, you're about to see the manifestation of the sons of God. And then He went on to say this. He described it as a divine shift in the body of Christ. Now listen to the words that He described to me. We have had degrees of change in the past where some things have already begun to shift, but that we are about to see a distinct, recognizable change that will propel the church into a supernatural season. Now, that was in 1998. And of course, you could look at some of those things and you could think, well, Lord, we never saw it come in 1999 or 2000 or 2001. We hadn't even seen some of it even manifest up to now. But I believe when this pandemic hit, whatever this was, however it came, when it was introduced into our world as we know it today, things began to shift dramatically. And I don't doubt that this is all part of what God was preparing us even back then for, that He was telling us that change is coming and that He was getting the church ready for a supernatural season. I don't know about you, but I'm excited because I know that even in the darkest moments of time, when the light is on, it shines brighter than any other time. And I believe the church is about to shine. I believe there's going to be some things that He wants to do in the church that is going to have that sovereign element where God's going to begin to initiate some things on His own. We're just going to be the carriers of what He wants brought forth in these last days. Can you say amen? Amen. And so I really don't know what the Great Reset Initiative is as far as what the world's wanting to set in place. We have some idea of it. But I do know that the Great Reset for the church is going to be about the supernatural that God wants to bring to us. Can you say amen?
Amen?
And so let me keep you in mind as to what this reset really involves, what we are looking at right now as far as the church and us individually as a church. And that is, number one, is that we've got to go back to our first love.
Yes.
If we're going to reset, you know, you reset a clock, you set it back to where it's supposed to be. You reset a computer, you drop everything that's open and you reset by going back to the basic. There's things in life that when you reset, it's starting over again. And in the spirit realm, we are to go back, as the scripture tells us, to make sure that our first love is fervent and that we have that in place in our Christian walk. that there are other things that can distract us, other things that can come along and pull on us, but we have got to maintain this main thing in our Christian life, and that is loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving one another as He loves us. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Secondly, we have to make sure Jesus is first in everything. I mean, before we consider anything, we have to consult Him. We have to go to Him and say, Lord, is this okay? Can I do this? Is this what You agree on? Or is this what You're ordering? Is this what You're telling me to do? And we have to make sure that whatever it is, it doesn't matter what it is, that He's first. Remember, the Bible says, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then thirdly, and this is really, really important, Sam hit on this a couple weeks ago, and that is really getting all the leaven out of our lives. Because all of us have areas that we know that we could work on. Some of them aren't as pretty as we would like them to be. Good opportunity for an amen.
Amen.
I'm just believing that y'all are thinking instead of speaking. Can you say amen? But now, we shared this with you last week. I want to just mention it again. When Jesus illustrated how that in troubled times or hard times, what we said were hard to do, hard to bear, hard to take, perilous times that we are living in, that we've got to make sure that we build our house upon the rock and not on the sand. Because when He looked in Matthew chapter 7, He gave that parable. He said, both houses receive the rain, the flood, and the wind. You know, just being a Christian doesn't mean that you get outside of the troubles that go on in the world.
That's right.
You're right smack dab in the middle of everything that's going on, and sometimes there's casualties in war. Even though you're not trying to get hit, there's times that stray bullets can even fly and hit you. Can you say amen? But there's protection. Thank God for the child of God that builds his house upon the rock, because it said that even though the rain comes and the floods come and the winds blow vehemently, it says it will not even be shaken. Now, we know, according to Hebrews 12, there is a shaking coming. He said everything that can be shaken will be shaken, and only that which cannot be shaken will remain. So, you know, we have some things that we have to consider. And I want to look at a couple of things. The Scripture talks a lot about our foundation. Jesus said that when He said, whom the men say that I am, and Peter said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God, He said, upon this rock, not Peter, but upon the revelation of what Peter got, He said, I'm going to build My church. I'm going to build My church. And of course, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 tells us that there is no other foundation that can be laid than Jesus Christ Himself. So He is our foundation. Can you say amen?
Amen.
But now look at this. Look at this. Over in 2 Timothy, if you want to just look over there with me, or you just want to hear this out, but 2 Timothy chapter 2, he says this. He says, study to show thyself approved unto God. This starts in verse 15. A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, but shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase more unto more ungodliness. I think some of that may be going on in Congress, don't you think?
Yeah.
And their word will eat as doth a canker or cancer, of whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying that the resurrection is past already, and overthrow the faith of some. Look at verse 19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are His, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Now, I meant to bring this out to you last week, and I just let it slip, so I'm going to go back and get this so you can hear me out. In Matthew chapter 7, when Jesus was describing this about the house that's built on the rock and the house that's built on the sand, he preceded this with these words, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is heaven. Many will say unto me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works." But notice verse 23. He says, "And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." Now put that together with Timothy. "The Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." So what is it that can cause a person to be able to do the works of God and yet not even be known of God? That's a pretty amazing thought, isn't it? But look over here to 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and I'll give you the reason. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, look at verse 3. Listen very carefully to what Paul is saying here. "If any man love God, the same is known of him." If he doesn't know you, it's because somewhere along the line, either you chose not to love God or you fell out of love with God. And when Jesus appeared to those the churches in Revelation and he came to the church of Laodicea, the very thought of him saying, you know, or actually it was the church of Ephesus, he says, "I have somewhat against thee. I know your works, I know your labors," he said, "but I have somewhat against thee. You have left your first love. Repent and do the first works. Go back to your foundation and find out really where your heart's at in this thing." Praise God. Because I'm going to tell you, when you're tested, when you're tempted, it all goes back to your commitment to Christ. Yes. Are you going to hold fast? Or are you going to cave in? And this is where we're at in this world that we're living in. Things are coming along fast. Things are happening fast. And it's going to test everyone's foundation of what sort it is. And so, you know, we have some exhortation in the Scripture that we need to really pay attention to. So I'm going to ask you if you go with me to Colossians chapter 1, and let's look at this. Let's talk about it. Praise God. Hallelujah. Colossians chapter 1. We talked a little bit about this last Sunday, about who Christ is, that he's holding all things together. All things by him consist. That means he's holding it all together. He is the head, verse 18, of the body of the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead. That in all things, everybody say all things. That in all things he might have the preeminence. That it's all about him. Glory to God. And it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell, having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself. By him, I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven. And notice this, and you, everybody say me, that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Now, boy, I'll tell you, that's a big amen right there. Thank God he took all our sinfulness, and now he's going to be able to present us unto himself holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in his sight. But notice verse 23, if. Everybody say if.
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 If is a big word.
Yes.
It's a big word.
Yes, it is.
If ye continue in the faith, notice this, grounded and settled. and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard. Now, go over to chapter 2, look at verse 5. For though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Verse 6, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk you in Him, rooted and built up in Him, and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding therewith with thanksgiving. Now look again at verse 6. As ye have received Christ. Well, how did we receive Christ? I'm going to tell you exactly how we received Christ. I'm going to break it down to you a little bit. The very first thing that happened is you were enlightened. Whether you realize it or not, the truth came across your path. Something introduced you to the reality of who Christ is. And the moment that that truth hit you, there was light that came. An enlightenment to who He really is. Then the next thing that came was the challenge. It was the confrontation within your spirit, challenging you to accept that truth, to accept that light that was being dawned upon your heart. And then, of course, the third thing, which I think is really the most critical part, is we had to weigh it, we had to count the cost, we had to decide within ourselves, do we truly want to accept Jesus Christ into our life? That was the pattern that we all went through. Now, John said it this way. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shined in the darkness comprehended it not. And John said, concerning himself, he says, you know, the light came, but I was not that light. He said, I was just to bear witness of that light, that that light would come into the world. He said, and he says, and he that cometh into the world, he lighteth every man. Every man. He lighteth every man. Every man. Everybody say every man. He lighteth every man. I'm going to tell you something. Every single person, I don't care who they are. I don't care how wretched, how dark they are in sin, how hard they are against the gospel. Every man has an opportunity at some point for them to be enlightened. And that enlightenment is the presentation of the truth. Yes. If they receive it, then they can be born again. But if they reject it and they deny it, then that light is cut off from them and they walk in darkness. We have an opportunity in our walk to do exactly what He said here. As you have received Christ, so walk ye in Him. In other words, you have to go through the same process to walking in Him as it is to receiving Him. You have to be enlightened. Are you listening to me? You've got to be challenged. Yes. You've got to weigh it, and then you've got to decide for yourself. And when it comes to walking in Him, we're not talking about just generally walking in Christ. We're talking about a revelation. Because this phrase, in Him, is kind of like the pivot of everything that Paul preached. I want you to look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4 for a moment. We all know this. I mean, 130 times in the New Testament letters, it's mentioned in Him, in whom, through Him, through whom, in Christ. All of these are references to this anchoring phrase, in Him, in Christ. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. In Him we live and move and have our being. It's a very important little phrase. We've got to understand what it means. It's talking about our unity and our union with Him. But 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul says this to Timothy, beginning in verse 15, for though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet have you not many fathers. For in Christ Jesus I have begotten you through the gospel. Wherefore I beseech you, be followers of me. Verse 17. For this cause have I sent unto you Timotheus, who is my beloved son and faithful in the Lord, who shall bring you, he's talking to the church now, who shall bring you into remembrance of my ways, which be in Christ, as I teach everywhere and in every church. The message that Paul kept emphasizing everywhere he went is your union with him, your connection with Christ. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him and your involvement in a relationship with him, because that's how you're going to grow. Look at Ephesians chapter 4. Paul mentions here the gifts of of ministry, apostle, the prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers, and their mission and what their purposes are. And he says all of this is to help build us up, that you henceforth, verse 14, that you henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But look at this, verse 15. But speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. It's all about growing up into him. It's all about growing up into him. As you have received Christ, so walk ye in him. Walk in the revelation. There's a light that's got to dawn on you, is what that means. Then there's going to be the challenge. Are you going to get out of you and you're going to get into him? Are you going to set self aside and embrace his life? Paul said, it's no longer I that live, but Christ that liveth in me. What's that mean? He got a hold of this. He saw it. He realized it. He waited. He was challenged by it. And he decided, I'm going to let Christ crucify me. I'm going to not only be dead to me, but I'm going to be dead to the world. He said, God forbid that I should glory except in the cross, in whom the world is crucified to me and I unto the world. The world's dead to me, but I'm dead to the world. Amen. This is the revelation that Paul was trying to get across to the people. But then he didn't stop there. He said this after. He said in verse 6, as ye have received Christ, so walk ye in him. He says, rooted and built up in him. Now, I want to take a moment to talk about this for a second. Praise God. Because, see, there's a truth here we got to get. Rooted and built up. Say that with me. Rooted and built up. See, you're not gonna really get built up until first you're rooted. You got to get rooted. I said you got to get rooted. And I want you, if you would, go back with me to Psalms 139, because here's where we're going to see how this root system works. David begins this psalm saying, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsittings and mine uprisings. Thou understandest my thoughts afar off. Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. See, there's nothing we can hide from God. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, all, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind and before, laid thine hand upon me. He said, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain unto it. Whither shall I go from thy spirit, and whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up to heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me and thy right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light unto me. or about me. He says, yet the darkness hideth not from thee. The night shineth as the day, and darkness and the light are both alike to thee. See, it all affects us, but it doesn't affect him. He sees right through it all. The hidden things will be made manifest. Hallelujah. But then it seems like David is changing something here. And I want you to see the amazing part of how prophecy in the Old Testament works. Because he says in verse 13, for thou hast possessed my reins, thou hast covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, that thy soul knoweth right well. On the surface, if you just read that, David's talking about his mother's womb. He's talking about when he was a child, even as an embryo. He said he knew that he was being formed, and it was a wonderful thing that God was doing. I mean, I look at these youngins, even like our grandchild, and I think, you know, it's amazing. Little teeny tiny babies have everything that I've got. They're just minimal. They're just small. But they're formed in the womb from a seed. Isn't that amazing? How they can come out with all the right parts. And they can come out with all of them where they're supposed to be. God could only do that. Amen? Amen. And so David's admiring this. And then he gets into a spirit of prophecy. And he says this, my substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lower parts of the earth. Now, he can't be talking about the mother's womb because he's talking about the very lowest parts of the earth. Well, what does that trigger in your mind when you hear that phrase, in the lower parts of the earth? It ought to take you back to scriptures, especially the one in Ephesians where we were just at, in chapter 4, when Paul was talking about Jesus and how it says that he ascended up on high and led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Verse 9 says, now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into what? The lower parts of the earth. The lower parts of the earth. Now, if you know anything in the Greek, the phrase lower really should be lowest, lowest parts of the earth. And it's talking about the pit. It's talking about the lowest region of hell. You know, when you get something that really messes with you and really disturbs you and makes you angry because it's just so, you know, unnecessary or hits you from the wrong side, and you say, man, that's just the pits. Why do we say that? Because that's like the lowest, the most degradable, you know, worst thing that could happen. It's the pits. Why do we say that? Because that's where the worst possible thing can go. Jesus went to the very worst place he could possibly go to pay for our sin. Hallelujah. Now, David is saying that he was curiously wrought in the lower parts of the earth. Verse 16 says, thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. Boy, you know, if there is anything that ought to be a message to the world, it's this truth right here. That while Jesus was in the heart of the earth, that he was making his body. Just like in the womb, God is making our physical life. And David was recalling how that was such a fearfully and wonderfully made thing. He's telling us right here how God formed his body. How God took and allowed Jesus to go into the very heart of the earth as the seed. and to begin to build his church, member by member, member by member. And whether we realize it or not, it says here that he was doing this while we were yet unperfect. He was doing that, continuing it, when as yet there was none of us. Meaning that Christ built his church in the mind of God. He built it before it was ever manifested. You and I are in the book. All our members are in the book. And the message of reconciliation, if you go back to 2 Corinthians 5, the message of reconciliation is how God reconciled us in himself through Christ. Not covering, not exposing or declaring our trespasses, but having canceled them. Praise God. So the sinner is not going to hell because of his sin. What? The sinner's not going to hell because of his sin. The sinner's going to hell because he refused to accept the forgiveness of sin. And that comes only through receiving Christ Jesus. Amen. John chapter 16, the Holy Spirit, it says that he's come to convict the world of sin, of righteousness, of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. That's the only reason there's a conviction inside the sinner over his sin, is because he needs to accept the remedy. Yes. The sin has already been paid in full, but he's got to accept the one who made that provision. And so it's going to be a dark day for the sinner when he gets to hell and realizes that all his sins were forgiven and all he had to do was say yes to Jesus. But you have to say yes to Jesus. Can you say amen?
Amen?
And so here we find that Jesus made his body in the lowest parts of the earth. The word substance there actually should be embryo. My embryo was not hid from him when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lower parts of the earth. But now listen to this. This is so valuable for us to get. If Jesus went to the lowest parts of the earth to begin forming his body, there is no lower place to go. And if you were born out of the very heart of the earth, the very lowest place that you could be, then in your Christian life, you can't get any lower. All you can do is go up. So if whatever situation you're facing when in life, it doesn't matter how dark it seems, it can't get any darker than where you were first born. And if you could be born in the worst possible condition, then you can certainly survive in whatever it is that you're facing in life. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That's powerful. Now, let's go back over here and look at this rooted and built up into him. The concept is you got to be rooted. Well, what do? Roots go down under. Roots go into the soil. Some roots have tap roots that go down deep into the ground. Some of those major trees that have grown to tremendous heights can have a tap root 300 feet deep. Now, some of them, they don't grow straight down as tap roots. They spread out. Some of them may be like the sequoia trees out in California, what we call the redwoods. They can be over 300 feet tall, but their root system only 6 feet deep. Isn't that crazy? But it wasn't the depth that made the difference. It was how far they spread out. They say that some roots in trees can grow outward 3 times its height. Whoo!
three times its height. You get a 6-foot tree and its root system may be 18 feet away from its root, from its stem. So when you're looking at our Christian life being rooted, we have both the depth. We can go all the way to the very bottom where it started, and we can be rooted in where we were first born into the kingdom. Or we can spread those roots out to where we are so secure, so anchored. You know, it's interesting this morning, Dana, while we were praying that Lehman talked about you being anchored. I was sitting there thinking, Lord, she didn't know anything about this message today. But the word the Lord came to you is to be anchored. And see, that's where we all have to be. We have to get anchored. I'm going to tell you, when the winds blow and the floods come and the rains descend, we better be anchored. We better make sure that we have a good, solid foundation. But then once we start building this foundation, we start making sure everything's in order in our lives. I'm talking about our first love, Jesus being center, and that all the leaven's out. We're making examinations every day to make sure leaven's out. That's how we get rooted. But then we have to be built up. We have to be built up. Hallelujah. And that's what the Spirit was saying this morning, wasn't it? Preparation, and then what? Expectancy, and what was the last thing? Edification, building up, building up, building up. Now, I can't tell you how many things that God's wanting to tell us to do when it comes to this, but this to me seems like the most important. If you'll go with me to 1 John chapter 2, because this is where it all hinges. It all hinges. 1 John chapter 2. And we're not going to read all of this for the sake of time, but let me just say this. In verse 27, he says, "But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. And you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you of all things in his truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, you shall abide in him." You shall abide in him. Now watch this. Amplified Bible says, "But as for you, the sacred appointment." How many of y'all know you got an appointment with the anointing? Yes. "The sacred appointment," the unction, the anointing, "which you have received from him abides permanently in you. So then you have no need that anyone should instruct you, but just as his anointing teaches you concerning everything." Everybody say everything. Everything. "As just as his anointing teaches you concerning everything and is true and is no falsehood." Now listen very carefully. "So you must abide, live, never to depart, rooted in him, knit to him, just as his anointing has taught you to do." The anointing is to teach you to be rooted in him and knit in him. Because what the anointing does is it brings you close to God. It draws you into his presence to where it makes you aware of your need of him like you don't have any other need for anything. Hallelujah. Now, in the early church, see, we miss some of this, but in the early church, I have a book here called Deeper Experiences of Famous Christians. It's got some valuable teachings here or messages concerning people that have lived through the church age that really made a contribution to the church. But it says here concerning Theophilus of Antioch, writing around A.D. 170, this is about 100 years after the destruction of Jerusalem. It says, and not long after the time of the apostles, says that the name Christian, and you'll appreciate this, my brother, is derived from the Greek word for oil or chrism and means anointed one, referring to the fact that the followers of Christ were anointed with the Spirit. Living as so early a day and in the city where they were first called Christians, he explains, his explanation rather, seems to be a reasonable one. Perhaps, listen to this, perhaps it was because Christ was commonly called the Anointed. That is what the word Christ means, which led to Christians being called anointed ones or Christians. Theophilus says we are called Christian because we are anointed with the unction of God. Amen. That's what we are. We're Christian. We're anointed. And the reason is because we're in Him. He is the Anointed One. And if you're in Him, you're tied in to His anointing. And it says right here, it says, this anointing that you have received of Him, that abides in you, He says, it teaches you all things. Everything that you need to know comes through the anointing. Hallelujah. Now, as I said, a lot of the prophecies that came forth in the Old Testament, specifically Psalms, they were prophetic. I mean, you're reading David one minute talking about what's going on in his life, and the next minute he's just right there talking about things that we see fulfilled in the New Covenant. Can you say amen? Well, what was it that caused David to be so prophetic? It was because he was a worshiper. I said he was a worshiper. David got alone with God. He meditated on the Word day and night. And he spent time singing songs to God. And many of the Psalms were songs that were written. He just penned them as words, but they were songs. You know, years ago, I don't know, Deborah, you, Tim, you probably remember this. Some of you that have been around, Tom, been around a while, but you know, years ago when we first came into the charismatic movement, every song we sang were scripture. We just sing, great is the Lord, greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of His holiness. That's right out of Psalms. We'd sing the Psalms. We'd sing songs that were all scripture. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us to sing and make melody in our heart to the Lord with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Why? Because He said that's how you stay full of the Spirit. Isn't that what He said? Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns. Glory to God. Worship opens up the prophetic. Amen. Opens up the prophetic. It puts you in the stream of heaven. Glory to God. But you've got to start off with having that root system built into Him. To where you want to be a worshiper. I see sometimes people in the worship service, they're just looking at their phone and they're just not paying attention and they're just, I mean, you know, they don't have a root system. When that wind begins to blow, you know what? They're going to be shaken. You got to make up your mind. Come hell or high water, sink or swim, go over, go under. I'm plugging in and I'm not being moved. But you got to know that in your heart. You got to know that. And when you do, then it's going to acquaint you with what's in you, and that is the anointing. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, over in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, when Paul was talking about the Spirit here, he says, but he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Did you realize the word Christ is not Christ's name? He He's Jesus of Nazareth. But he's Christ because the word Christ is the word for Messiah. Christ is the anointed one, the one who was to come. Jesus Christ is not his first and last name. Jesus the Christ. He is the anointed one. So when you find scripture where it says that you are in Christ, it's talking about you being in the anointed one. You're in his anointing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what they got. That's what they understood in the early church. Well, here it says that we have the mind of what? Of Christ. Now, whether you realize it or not, when you are walking in the Spirit, he says here, he that is spiritual, so he's talking about spiritual, that when you're walking in the Spirit, you have the mind of the anointing. When you're in the Spirit, you have the mind. You say, you mean this? The anointing has a mind? Absolutely. How can I say that? Because it says there in 1 John that it teaches you. It teaches you in what? All things. The anointing is a teacher. It has to have a mind to be able to teach. Are you following me? And if you learn to walk in the anointing, it'll teach you everything you need to know. It'll teach you where to go, how to go, who to go with, who to stay away from, who to break things off with. The anointing of God will cause you to be able to make decisions that will bless you and not bring a curse upon you. The anointing will keep you well. Hallelujah. Protect you. It's the anointing that what? Destroys the yoke. You stay out of bondage to things if you'll walk in the anointing. Glory to God. So when we're talking about a reset, we're talking about coming into this season that God's bringing us into, this supernatural season, it's all going to be about the anointing. The anointing in us and the anointing upon us. And the Lord said this many years ago. He says, if you don't take care of the anointing within, you'll lose the anointing upon. Amen. You got to take care of what's in you. And that anointing in you is what ties you to Jesus, knits you to him, knits you, get rooted and knit to him. Hallelujah. And I promise you this right now, if you walk in this, if you'll develop in this, you'll never be fooled another day. How many of us have been fooled? Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, sometimes people can say all the right things and it sounds so good, it sounds so right, that we think, man, I need to be listening to this guy. And then we come down the road and find out that he's had an affair or he's in some kind of, you know, situation where he's extorting money. Something's wrong. We didn't pick it up. How come we didn't pick it up? Because we weren't walking in the anointing. The anointing will automatically give you a check. The anointing will automatically tell you this is right, this is not right. And you got to get to that place where you live this every day. And you can't unless, first of all, you get your root system straightened out and then you start building. And you start building what? You build it line upon line, precept upon precept, but you build it out of this right here. You build it out of this right here. Hallelujah. This is your life right here. Jesus said, the words that I speak in you, they're spirit and what? Life. This is life. This is life. Feed on it. Feed on it. Hallelujah. If he's called the living word and this is the written word, then the anointing that's on him is in here as well. So fellowship with him, spend time with him, worship him, but get in here and not just read it like you would a newspaper, but get in here and read it like it's your breakfast, it's your lunch, it's your supper. Feed on it. And let this word get on the inside of you, and the anointing on it will get in you. and your worship, the anointing on him will come in you. And you'll begin to start walking in this. Hallelujah. And if there's any time that the church needs to be anointed, I'm telling you, it's now. Yes. Yeah. We don't have time to develop this. We've got to be walking in it now. And your Christian life, listen, yeah, I'm going to tell you the truth. Your Christian life is going to be tested. You're going to have situations that you're going to be confronted with that if you don't know how to use the anointing to get your answers to the situation you're faced with, you're not going to be strong. You're not going to be a witness. You're not going to be a testimony. Paul said, I bring my body into subjection that lasts after I preach to others, I myself may not be disapproved or cast away, as the King James says. I don't want to be an item that the Lord looks at and thinks, I can't use you. When he talked about the foundation of God standeth sure, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. He goes on and talks about, in every house there are vessels of gold and wood. Some to honor, some to dishonor. But if you will purge yourself from these things, you'll be a vessel unto honor, meet for the master's use, prepared. Prepared. What was the word this morning? Prepare unto every good work. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I want us to stand, and I want us to just reach around, and I want us to get a hold of somebody. If you want to just go face to face, you want to minister one to another, that's fine with me, however you feel led to do this. But I'm telling you right now, we need a supernatural reset. We need God to say, okay, we need the Holy Spirit on the inside of us to say, okay, are you ready? And for us to say, yes, Lord, we're ready. We're ready. We're ready, Lord. We're ready to run with you. We're ready to walk with you. We're ready to stand with you. We're ready, Lord, to take whatever the enemy wants to throw at us. We know, Father God, that you are our defense. You're our shield. You're our buckler. Lord, you're our exceeding great reward. And Lord, we're not afraid of anything. Lord, you've not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. We know that we have the anointing within us. We know that that anointing can guide us and lead us and teach us and show us whatever we have need of. And that, Father, that we're not without, that we are fully represented in this earth with all the heaven's supply. Everything that we have need of. Jesus even said that he could call down 12 legion of angels if need be. Lord, we have that available to us, that if we have to have angels come into our situation, that we have them available to us. We thank you for the blood. We thank you for the blood. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the praise that we can give you, Lord, that it stills the enemy. We thank you today, Father God, that we are well supplied with everything that we have need. And Lord, we want to be people that are easily affected by the Spirit. We want to be people that are sensitive to the Holy Ghost. We want to be people, Lord God, that are aware and quick in our spirit to pick up things. So acquaint us, Lord, again. Acquaint us again. Cause that first love to be stirred up in us. That, Father God, that we're sensitive, that we're quick to hear, quick to obey. And that, Father God, that we don't miss it. We don't miss it. We don't miss it. I prophesy over every one of us that our days of missing it are coming to an end.
Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
And that we're going to walk in this way. Perfectly walk in this way. Father, I thank you for every single one in this room. Lord, I pray over them. I pray for their foundation. I pray that they just take this time right now to just dig deep, dig deep, dig deep, dig deep. Just go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. And Father, to where nothing can move them. That nothing can move them. Nothing can move them. Not whatever comes upon this earth will move them. Oh, Father, just help us right now. Go ahead and pray for that person you're with right now. Just pray for them. And just release the anointing. Release what's in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Give us the mind of the anointing. Pull us out of that natural realm and help us to walk in a spiritual realm, in that supernatural realm, for this supernatural season that you're bringing us into. Hallelujah. Lord, we don't know what kind of reset the world is trying to establish, but we know the reset that you're trying to establish in us. And we take it seriously, Lord, to go back and examine everything that needs to be fixed, everything that needs to be straightened out. Hallelujah. Lord, you're enlightening us to walking in Him. You're challenging us. Now it's up to us to weigh it, to count the cost, and to decide. Are we going to run with you, Jesus? Are we going to run with you? Are we going to run with you? Father, I just pray right now for 100% participation in this body. 100% committed. 100% running. 100% founded, grounded, settled. Right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, just as you prayed that not one would be taken, not one would be lost. Hallelujah. I bind up every spirit of hell that would try to separate and divide and pull apart and cause a weariness of mind and body. To wander, Lord. We sometimes, like sheep, we wander from the fold. Lord, I pray that they just be drawn back. Hallelujah. Like the shepherd that takes his rod and he hooks the neck of that sheep and he pulls it back into the fold, Lord. We just search the hearts of those that have maybe wandered some, Lord, that we just pull them right back. To you, Jesus. To you, Lord. Hallelujah. Glory be to Jesus. Glory be to Jesus. Lord, we thank you today. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, that it's all about you. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. And we love you. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Do you know that old chorus, I love you, Lord?